You see, Africa, you know. Africa, you understand. Africa, you celebrate. On Kakaaki, the African voice. The African.
Alright, we're talking restructuring and the call to renegotiate Nigeria. Former Vice President Atiku Abubakar has for some time now been advocating for that. In fact, he's been on the front line for that call for restructuring the country. And this time around, he said, unlike what different people have been saying, Nigeria is negotiable. Atiku described the current system as strange federal contraption and said the current economic challenge had their root in the bad political structure of the country. Now let's give you some of the details which he presented at that occasion. He said they believe that what necessitated the current over-centralized and center-dominated federal system is as a result of political expediency and fear bolstered by the command and control character of military regimes. And after 50 years, Atiku says, 50 years of unitary federalism, it is clear that the system is not working because unlike the current state, the regions in the First Republic had autonomy and do not wait for the federal allocation or federal locations before implementing the programs to pay and to pay salaries. Atiku also said that when federating units had greater autonomy, the regional governments did not owe salaries for several months, shut down schools and universities due to strike. He also said that over the years, industries and establishments taken over by governments at the center have not performed well. We will be revisiting the debate on restructuring and fiscal federalism and the option of renegotiating Nigeria. We have joining us now from our Lagos Center, the Secretary of Lower Niger Congress, Tony Nnadi. Tony Nnadi, good to have you there.
Good morning, Kevin. Thanks for having me.
Point and the need for restructuring or renegotiating Nigeria. When people say, or like the former vice president talked about renegotiating Nigeria, what in your opinion did he really mean?
Just like all the Nigeria has become used to empty sloganeering and jingoism. One moment, change. Everybody shouts change. Nobody wants to examine the content. Now we're talking restructuring all over the place. Some of us, luckily, some of us who have been on the search for how this union could work, and if it's not working, how it could be peacefully dismantled into what could work, had found a way to get ourselves together to build such a critical mass that to convince all concerned, including the government, to get back to that discussion, because the house will collapse on everybody's head if that is not done. And it's in course of this attempt to build that consensus countrywide that things like Pronaco had happened, went on to the MNN, that it even went to court challenging the existing constitution. And of late, as recent as September, when the former vice president had gone to Kaduna to remind those who were opposed to restructuring that the end point of that stance, that hard stance against restructuring, will be an unceremonious collapse of the union. Some of us had consultations amongst ourselves, and we decided to go to interrogate what he was speaking about, whether he was now on the same page with the rest of us who have been saying it for many years, almost getting 20 years now. And such was it that we went and we had that meeting. I will say the article that is speaking now is not the article, the politician. That was my assessment after an eyeball to eyeball interrogation of what he was talking about, comparing what with what we were talking about all the while. And he was quite blunt in saying that his concern, because a lot of people will say, oh, because he has to contest the election in 2019, he wants to buy a cheap sympathy. He said his concern was that if we do not resolve this matter, from what he now knows, that there may be no Nigeria to conduct any election even in the 2019 as near as it seems to many. And therefore, the restructuring he was talking about, the language he has used now, because this is about the third public intervention. In June, at the Biafra book launch, of course, he made the first loud statement. Then subsequently in July in Kaduna, he also told the people, his audience, that that the North will lose more if they do not come to meet the rest of the country halfway. And now he goes one further step, and that's very critical, to say that the existence, the very existence of Nigeria has to be negotiated. And why I say he took a further step is that, as it is, the Federation of Nigeria is in technical dissolution. It collapsed since 1966. All the attempts to bring it back to life have been rebuffed by, you know, a section of the country, and to the point now where we are closer to an undiscussed dismantling, because everybody waving their own flags here and everywhere. You go to the eastern side, it's Biafra all over the place. You come to Yoruba side, they're just sitting and looking. And you come to the middle belt where people are being slaughtered house to house. Nobody is thinking about the Nigeria the way it should have been, because yes, the country is there. Sokoto will not move. Kano will not move. Maiduguri will not move. Port Harcourt will not jump into the ocean. The country is just the geographical expression it has always been. But the Federation is one in which the peoples of all those territories are joined together in one union. And that is what the Constitution does. What we're talking about restructuring is to say that the agreement that brought us together into one union at independence had been abandoned and jettisoned since 1966. And what we have in place, which the 1999 Constitution we've been shouting about all these years, is an imposition. And what it has done is to distort the Federation that we had, almost putting it in an inverted situation. A Federation is a union of constitution. I want to break it down to the understanding of all of those who might be listening, wherever they may be. A Federation is simply a union of constitution that is giving an interpretation to restructuring in the manner that article is speaking about now, in the manner we have been speaking about. A Federation is a union of constitutions, which means that it is just like countries that want to cooperate so that they can have a larger size and an economy of skills. And what we had at independence was where one in which the western region, as far back as 1957 towards independence of 1960, had their own constitution in their hand. The eastern region followed. The northern region came along in 1959, and it was these three constitutions that were federated by negotiation in the Lancaster House conferences in London that became one federal union, because these three could have gone off into their independence after the British colonial adventure. And it was the jettisoning of those constitutions that defined the Federation. There would have been no one country called Nigeria if not for the level of autonomy that was agreed at the time they were going into that union. So to have abandoned that autonomy in by jettisoning those constitutions that come to, just like Europe, under European, like European Union, in which Germany and France and Portugal are cooperating to form one larger union. That was the kind of thing Nigeria went into at independence. So for those five constitutions, that's four regional, Western, Eastern, Northern, and the Midwest that came in 1963, and then the federal, the one in which they donated some of their powers to a central authority to take care of some of the responsibilities. Of course, the financing being a contribution from them. What happened to us in 1966 was that that whole arrangement got toppled upside down, and that center that was created seized the entire territory and began to do things, creating states from 1967 to topple the foundation upon which the entire thing rested. And the assets of these federating units became confiscated by the center, and they're still holding it to date. The power to work those assets became confiscated, and we have 68 items today on the constitution 1999. And the consequence of it is that the federating units, which are now called states, are not in any position to do most of the things that governance should be all about, the things the regions were doing, which was reason why we had we're now looking back into that first republic as the golden era of the go back there.
Let's just be clear on some of the points you've made so far. Let's make it a bit brief so that we can interact properly. Restructuring does not mean suppression. Is that the point you're making?
Restructuring is like a reconstruction. And it presents a gamut of outcomes depending on the goodwill still left to federate. Where we are now, by 1966, especially in 1967, when the matter went to Aburi, for that Nigeria collapsed, and the leaders from the four regions of the time went to Aburi to try to re-establish the union. And what was available at that time, the opportunity that was lost at that time, was to get back to those four regions, you know, being in one union. From that time, that opportunity remained in place all the way to where we did Pronaco 2004-2005, concluding 2006. And we had a draft constitution that would have taken us as close to where we should have been as possible. Again, the same set of people blocked it. But the new thing now came, in which there was Sharia introduced by 12 contiguous states. I wish the camera could pick the picture I have here. There was Sharia in which 12 contiguous states of the far north introduced the Sharia simultaneously in 2000 and started enforcing it in a manner that dislocated people from the rest of the country. And we now have that additional distortion to the discussion that was going on about how we live together. Where we are now is that restructuring can end in a federation like the US has. Restructuring can end in a confederation like European Union has. Restructuring can also end in a no federation situation in which like Soviet Union went from being one country to about 15 countries now. And the danger is that those who have been pressed so hard have come to the conclusion that it's better for them to leave the union. And for people like us who had done so much of trying to make the union work, to come again 50 years after genocide was launched against one part of the country, to where that same part is being militarily occupied again, and people being killed with reckless abandon, we are much more closer to where we will discover a majority do not want to continue in the union of attrition.
Yes, is it your point, Tony, that I said earlier, let's make your points a little bit brief so that we can interact properly. Is it your point that restructuring has an option for whoever wants to leave the union to do so? Is that what you're saying?
Let's not box the discussion into an impossible angle. first things first, let us accept that the 1999 constitution by which Nigeria's democracy is being operated right now is an imposition arising from the invasions and the conquests of 1967 to 1970 by the victorious alliance. Just like apartheid constitution was imposed against by a minority against the majority, if we accept that, we'll then come to the next bus stop of what do we do to replace it, what do we do to reach new agreements, what do we do to forge a new federation in the manner Atiku Abubakar is suggesting. That is where that negotiation comes in, and it is just a function of the goodwill to continue in one union, and it has to go to referendum, especially in the camp of those who are now saying they do not want to continue in a union where some owe it a duty to their faith to kill the infidel. A feudal system in which you have those who claim they are born to rule others and who have seized the assets of others by sheer military adventurism.
Those who achieve that would require a huge legal hurdle. Let's look back a bit to where we are coming from. 1967 to 1970, the breaking down of the structure, the regional structure, was a post-Civil War phenomenon, that we have the state structure that we have today from the regions we had before. Atiku Abubakar talked about political expediency, which led to this. He also talked about fear, and I suppose he was referring to the fear of having a regional structure where you have a cluster of states working together who perhaps have been able to utilize their resources in such a manner that they become very strong and they become perceived as a threat to others or a threat to the center, which I suppose was the reason why he said, okay, let's break down this eastern region that wants to, you know, succeed from Nigeria, and let's have states, different states, form out of them. Is that fear still a potent fear in the country as at now? Because the former vice president talked so much about that, the political expediency. Do we still have that need for political expediency, and is that fear still existing at the moment, looking at how far we've gone from 1970 to where we are now, where you're having, you know, people from the eastern, old eastern region in different parts of the country have invested so much of their resources in those parts of the country? It was quite similar to that way back as well. So is that fear still something that's logical or exists only in the imagination of some people?
I assure you that fear is worse now than it was in 1967. And I'm not speaking from the sidelines, I'm speaking in my capacity as the Secretary General of the Lower Niger Congress, which can claim to speak for those who are now saying they want to leave the Union in that territory. I can also speak on a countrywide scale, which was the reason we went to interrogate Atiku on the issue, as the co-convener of the Movement for New Nigeria. By the way, the map of that New Nigeria was the map I was showing you a short while ago, to say that we have come to where those things that were done, the states were not created post-war. The states were created, the first set of states were created 3 days before the declaration of Biafra. At the time, the Easterners were being slaughtered all over the rest of the country, and they fled eastwards. And that danger seemed to be pursuing them back home, and it fell on the shoulders of the then governor of the East to find a way to draw a line where people who are still alive will not be killed any further. It was in the period of that decision to draw that line that the government at the center, led by Gawan, now decided to, you know, truncate the basis of the region by creating states. So eastern region was split into the rivers and the southeast southeast state of the time being now Akwa Ibom and Cross River, to undermine the region and make it impossible for that region to stand up to defend those who had not been killed at the time. And from that point to date, it has been a further deterioration and deterioration, such that we now have 36 states hanging loose with no capacity, except perhaps for Lagos, with no capacity to fend for themselves, because there's now oil money to use to fend for them. 774 local government areas created by fiat. And you see who and who have done those things, and you see what it has resulted in, the places where people are now saying they don't want to continue in that union. Assets that were seized, representation that is now one in which a majority has become a minority. The Igbo that all over the country can no longer have a voice in how their lives are run, whether it's the road they want to do or the electricity where they want to do. The only reason why I don't have electricity in the East today is that I cannot generate it, I cannot transmit it. And that is what the Constitution imposes on me. So those are the reasons, and it doesn't seem to be abating at all. Look at the last election. Look at what has followed. Look at how the governance is going on. And now we have operation of pythons and crocodiles dancing and smiling all over the place. Who wants to live with that?
Let's also look at the aspect of equitable distribution of resources. I looked through some of the recommendations that were made in the 2014 National Conference and even the 2005 National Political Reform Conference, and that's a component of the fear which we are talking about, the fact that a large chunk of the resources of this country, because I suppose resource control is at the center of all of this agitation as well. A large chunk of the resource of this country on which Nigeria earns its foreign exchange comes from a particular region of this country, which in essence is redistributed to every other person in every other region, in every other state in this country. How then do you ensure that such persons do not starve, such persons do not go hungry, and that there is some level of equitable use of resources? I know the argument would be, yes, there's no region in Nigeria, there's no state in Nigeria where there is no resource, but we're talking about the level of development of such resource. I'm sure you saw the recommendation in 2014 National Conference report. How then do you deal and help people who have that fear that if this restructuring we are talking about comes to be, that it might be favorable to some and far less favorable to others?
Bring your federation. If you bring your federation to a situation where it is working for some, is not working for the others, you have destroyed that federation, because those for whom it's not working are going to take steps to leave that federation. It's as simple as that. Before we begin to talk about distribution, the question of ownership of the assets will have to be established. Because if a federation is a union of constitutions, each constitution is coming with all of what it owns, its people, its assets, to relate with the others, still being recognized as the owner, but contributing to the center, maybe higher than what others bring. That's what was agreed at the beginning. That was what was abandoned, at the point in time in which Gowon in 1967 was, 1966, July 66, at the point in time Gowon was telling the world that the basis of the federation was no more. It is that basis that we seek to reestablish. Back to the matter of distribution. What is Nigeria? We have come to that crossroad where we have to answer that question. If you want to understand that question, you go to the preamble of the constitution, current constitution, which says, we the people have solemnly resolved to live in a union, to be governed according to this constitution, which we now make and give unto ourselves. It is like the memo and articles of a company. People see the document, memo and article, as one document, but they are two different documents. The memo creates the company where Johnson and Jude and Michael have come together to you know, submit themselves and their assets into an enterprise with the name XYZ Limited. The articles now begin to say what XYZ Limited will do amongst themselves. That's the owners of XYZ Limited. That's the as it is with the company and its memo and article. So it is with the constitution that first says that we are submitting our land and our people into this union to be managed according to this constitution. If you do not resolve that first leg of we submitting to this union, all the other things you write about the second leg, you know, is a waste of your time. And that is where we have landed now, that the constitution in place is done against the will of those who are called Nigerians. So talking about who our assets are shared is way too far secondary from the issue at stake.
Now, because I've heard you in several forums, I think you even filed a case in court, I think some 10 years ago, where you said the constitution we're using now is a fraud. The preamble that we the people does not represent we the people. At no point did Nigerians sit and said this is how we want it to be. It was a military contraption. How then do you resolve that legal quagmire? Because for whatever it's worth that is being agitated for, you need to have a legal basis to have it pulled through. How do you resolve that?
I'm a lawyer of 25 years with a specialty in jurisprudence. The way to resolve it is to accept that we have not agreed. What South Africa did with apartheid constitution, which was imposed by that minority, is what we must do now if we are still discussing any union. If we fail to do it, those who are talking are going to advance the steps they're already taken, and I'm in the thick of that those steps to retrieve their portion from the fraud that have come to not only seize their assets but now killing them in order to retain those assets. What we must do is to it will take only one announcement by the president to declare, like Frederick de Klerk did in 1990 with the apartheid constitution, to say we have not made a constitution. We are not anarchists, therefore we will take a period of transitioning to discuss the replacement. Those in government, the governance structures can remain on that transitional basis. It took South Africa 5 years, but it may not take us 5 years today because of the work that have been done with by Tunaco and all kinds of other groups. The National Conference outcome, which many people are pointing at, you know, remember the first decision on that floor of that conference was to say that we will not discuss the terms of our union. All the nonsense they did in the conference removed the basis, you know, destroyed the basis of calling the conference. So that nobody should even talk about that, because they're still talking about creating more states and all kinds of nonsense. We come to where, unless we do what Frederick de Klerk did in 1990 in South Africa, to set aside that, put aside that constitution, and discuss how we want to live, the union is defunct. That's how simple it is.
Talk about how that can be achieved in the current Nigeria that we find ourselves today. Recently, I'll bring you some of the things that the president has said as far as this issue is concerned, and get your reaction on that as a basis for us to move further in this discussion. But that will be after this news break. Pan-Africa World coming up next.
Keep the African voice.
Also, you have the Secretary of the Lower Niger Congress with us, Tony Nadi from our Lagos Center. We're still talking restructuring. Now, Tony, before we went on that news break, I wonder whether the former Vice President, Atiku Abubakar, taking his message to the people in the northern part of the country, is preaching to the choir. I mean, when you hear the sound bites coming from some persons from that region who really do not support this call for restructuring, and even the president himself, who recently said, look, Nigeria's unity is non-negotiable, how then do you cross this very big barrier?
The president is behind the times on that issue. It was the same Muhammad Buhari that stood at the podium at the United Nations asking his colleague heads of state and government to facilitate the independence, the rights to self-determine for the Palestinians and the Sahrawi Arab Republic of Morocco. There came in 2007 an instrument from the UN to settle the kind of matter that Nigeria has found itself confronted with. That instrument has to do with what we call self-determination. And it is that self-determination that those who do not, who appear not to be aware of that paradigm change, are still calling secession and treason and taking people to trial for insisting that they are no longer interested in what was imposed on them. And where we are on it is that whether anybody in Nigeria likes it or not, including Buhari, that right with the UN, by which the UN seeks to remove most of the wars. The UN discovered that all the wars, whether it's the First World War, the Second World War, all the wars in Africa and elsewhere, arose from one form of ethnic domination or the other. If it is not Hitler declaring that the Nazis were superior to everybody else, it will be the Tutsi being overwhelming the Hutus, or the Fulani insisting they are born to rule the rest. What the UN did by that instrument was to say, look, from now on, if you are in your ancestral space, no matter how small you are entitled to be there by yourself. And if anybody wants to be in a union or with you or some other business that will bring you, all of you interacting, that person must convince you. If you are not convinced, that person has to dress back from you so that you can use what you find in your space to the best of your ability to seek your advancement and happiness. And what that introduces to let us take Nigeria so that we can put it in context. Let us take Nigeria as a sick, as a sick patient which has to be treated. That sickness is the over-centralization that came upon us in 1966. That is unitarism. That's the name of the sickness. The cure to that sickness is federalism. The treatment plan that will deliver that cure is called restructuring. And the very medicine, the very potent medicine that is at the heart of that treatment plan is called self-determination. So that if we accept that this patient is sick unto death, unlike what some people, including our president, seem to be saying, that look, this patient must, there's nothing wrong with it, it has to be the way it is, if the rest of us, because he's only one person, he only happens to be president for now, if the rest of us insist, like Atiku is insisting, like those who are waving Biafran flags in the East are insisting, that we must take charge of what happens to us in keeping with that right that have been established. If we accept that this patient has to be treated, and we go into the process of the treaty, it is that self-determination that makes it imperative to go to that renegotiation now. Otherwise, those who organize themselves will go to a referendum, and I can assure you that steps have been taken. I have myself been in places of discussion in New York, in Washington, everywhere those who are going to get involved, because Nigeria, if Nigeria boils over, there are many stakes, that there are many things that will go wrong in many places. So we are discussing these things everywhere they have to be discussed, and we will go to referendum in the formations that we saw Scotland going to referendum in the UK the other day. We saw the UK itself going to referendum in EU. What is it about Nigeria in which 3.5 million people have been killed in eastern Nigeria not to go to a referendum on this issue? Somebody
I asked, do we have a constitutional basis for a referendum in this country?
About, we are saying that we have not made a constitution. The decree number 24 of 1999 that Absalami and his co-travelers imposed on us cannot be basis of trading away my sovereignty. What we have in Nigeria today is a sovereignty called Nigeria, suppressing the sovereignties that are supposed to compose Nigeria. The same way the sovereignty called Britain suppressed our sovereignties all the period up to 1960. So what we have now is that some other group have taken over that shoe of Britain to call, lump us together by decree, call it Nigeria, define it the way they want, take over whatever they feel like taking over, and, you know, wielding a power of life and death over me, and then calls it democracy. It's not democracy for me.
You cited the Scottish example, but there in that region, they have a legal basis for them to have called for that referendum. That's why I asked, do we, because it's easy for us to say we'll invoke, convoke a referendum, but you need somebody to convoke a referendum, and you need a legal basis to convoke a referendum. But if you are saying we don't even have a legal basis at all, because the constitution we are operating is a fraud, that means we don't have any basis legally to call this entity Nigeria. So what is your starting point?
Point is to accept the truth. The truth being that the basic the basis of Nigeria, the federation, the constitution that defined the federation of Nigeria was toppled by force, and now we have a replacement by decree. And after 50 years, those who impose that replacement by force are telling us to our faces that it's no longer available for discussion. The starting point will be to look at the UN instrument on the matter, because this case falls squarely into that category. And if we accept that we have not agreed, as claimed in this constitution, because that we the people means that we the Ijo, we the Ogoni, we the Idoma, we the Kataf have discussed, we the Yoruba have discussed amongst ourselves and come to the conclusion that we want to be in one country, that claim is false. And if it is on the basis of that falsehood that people are selling 3 million barrels of crude oil every day, killing whoever tried to challenge them, if it is on the basis of that falsehood that I'm not able to take the coal I have in eastern Nigeria to generate electricity, Aba is dying, Onitsha is dead, Nnewi is dead, because somebody from Sokoto or Kano wrote it into a decree, and then they call it constitution. We are saying that we do not have a constitution in place. We are not anarchists. Therefore, we are prepared to accept a transitioning in which the governance structures we have will remain on a transitional basis for us to quickly discuss how we can refloat the dead union. The Federation of Nigeria is dead. The country is still there, pretending to be alive. But the Federation is that agreement for us to be one union. That agreement is not there as of today. And if anybody is thinking that deployment of troops will keep the union for him,
that person must be hallucinating because it's not going to hold for a long time. It's not going to hold. Those who from that eastern part go to sit in Abuja in the name of this constitution are telling the people who have been killed and shot and traumatized that they would rather go with the enemy. And we're just saying that let the matter not come to where those who are being shot, you know, begin to do whatever come to their hand to do. Whereas the Lower Niger Congress is standing in a very difficult middle in that situation. The Avengers are already throwing bombs. The Masob and IPOB people are still being persuaded that we can go to a referendum on this issue, that there can be a transition, in that we must shut out violence in the matter. But those who are deploying troops to respond to a matter of simple constitutional grievances that are well known should realize that they are the ones who have made the Union of Nigeria impossible.
You said the government has responded to that Amnesty International report on the killings of agitators in the southeast. They said they've denied it. They said they didn't do it anyway, but that's a subject matter for another day. We're still talking about this other region because as much as we talk about what is fair to those who have resources, quote and unquote, natural resources embedded on their soil, we also look at other people from other regions and other places in the country. I want to ask you, what, for instance, will non-oil producing states and states who do not have seaports, regions who don't have seaports, what would they depend on if we are able to, for instance, achieve this kind of restructuring which we are talking about? What would they depend on?
When people were carving out states as they didn't fit, some to settle their concubines, others to, or for all kinds of reasons, because there was oil money they could take from, the oil having been hijacked and confiscated by force. When they were creating those states and local government areas, we have 774 in number as at now. Kano has 44, and it was from Kano that Jigawa was cut out. Jigawa has almost 30 or something, and Bayelsa, from where that money must be taken, has only 8. Jonathan was president. There was nothing he could do to add to that in Bayelsa or to subtract from that in Kano, because those who have to decide it already outnumber all of us in the place of decision, all by the fiat of decrees. That was how we came about the number we have in all those places. We're saying, let first things be settled first. Let us accept that we have to redefine the federation, the terms of the federation. The conference in 2014 decided, because of that conspiratorial alliance between the north, the conservative north, and the renegade wing of the southwest, which form a majority. Let me tell you, and I speak on behalf of those who are now saying they don't want to continue in this journey to nowhere, in this journey of death in the eastern side. You may shout Nigeria as loud as you like. You may sing your anthem 20 times in one day. Those being shot, those whose assets are seized in the creeks, those being shot on the streets of Aba, there is an imaginary map in their mind upon which they place the actors in this whole shenanigans. They ask themselves, who is the commander-in-chief that sent this army? They place him on that map. Who is the GOC in Enugu or Port Harcourt? They place that GOC on that map. Who is the commander in the field, that's the in the Aba or Nicha or Yenagua or Boni, that is being occupied? They place them. Who are the police commanders, aiding? They place them. Who is speaking to the international community? Oh, Musa Sagir. They place him. Who is controlling the media reporting these killings as not happening, because that is part of what we have seen? They place them, because there you begin to see the southwest turning up. Those people are entitled to make their deductions from the fact of what they see, that people from some the rest of the country, so to say, are now parading, masquerading, and marauding in the name of Federal Republic of Nigeria, in the name of Federal Government of Nigeria, to do what they did in 1967 to 1970 in the East one more time. That is what is going on. That's the interpretation going on in the place. And it comes to the point where it may boil over. Like I said before, we are standing in a difficult middle, trying to persuade those who are still non-violent in their approach to say we can maintain it because of this instrument that makes it possible for us to go to a referendum. We can go to a meeting. We've been at it for so long. But the very same people who ganged up in that 1967 sordid episode are the ones telling us now that the matter is not up for discussion. I pray it doesn't come to where it is settled on the streets. We have no quarrel with those from Katsina and Kano who are in that operation in the East. All our quarrel, you know, starts and ends with our own people who hold onto this constitution as the basis of their authority. They must join us, whether they are governors or senators or assembly members or even party proprietors. Those talking about election in 2019 on the basis of this constitution to go and reinforce and renew it are going to find out that the people who will die as long as this constitution remains in place will do anything to prevent them from renewing the democracy and the governance structures and the processes under this constitution one more time. We have almost 2.5 years to the next point of the election they're advertising. Atiku is shouting and crying now, nobody's listening to him, that we should seize the moment, seize this period to go and discuss that Nigeria so that we can re-establish that Nigeria as basis of election. Those from the East who are going to join the enemy to hold on to this constitution because of what they get every month are going to have to confront those people being shot in the name of Nigeria that does not exist. In Eastern Nigeria, Lower Niger Congress is shouting it to the whole world to hear that Nigeria as it is now was not the Nigeria we went into. It has been turned into something else, and it is costing blood, costing livelihoods. The region is being occupied by people from the rest of the country, and they call it democracy.
Well, simply, yeah, as much as we talk about equitable distribution of resources and justice and fairness, my question was, what happens to those in other regions where they're not oil producing, although they're telling us they're sourcing for oil in the Chad Basin and several other places? They don't have seaports as well. How then do you expect these people to survive? Because whether you like it or not, whether you might not believe in the concept of Nigeria, these are human beings. And for years, this is the status quo that we have known. So how then do you ensure survival and sustenance for those ones?
Them a living. Does Japan have oil? Oil is the most, you know, the worst distraction anybody can be citing in this kind of a thing. There are 1 million things that can keep us going. Is it oil that Philippe Magwale is producing that makes him what he is today? There's one HRO that had to sell something of knowledge for $1 billion, which Nigeria cannot easily afford. I'm sure his state government cannot afford it. We are talking about the right to live. Somebody owes it a duty to his faith to kill me, the infidel. That is my first concern. I'm not asking anybody to come and give me anything. I want to take the coal I have to fire a power plant that will generate electricity for me. The government of Eastern Region realized that we needed electricity for Aban, Onitsha and Port Harcourt to grow, and they set up Oji River Power Plant. The forces that call themselves Nigeria now shut down that plant. Today I don't have electricity except as Nigeria will give. The roads that connect Enugu to Port Harcourt and all the other federal roads in the East are in such a horrible state because they are federal assets and they can only be how anybody wants them to be. The port in Port Harcourt was asset of Eastern Nigeria under Emir Abara. at the time he planned the regional economy that was the fastest growing in the then third world, which includes the Asian tigers of today. What is this discussion about oil? If people do not want to fend for themselves, there are 1 million things that they can use to fend for themselves. Why must they suck my blood to live? If we have brought our situation to the point where it is now mutually exclusive, if I'm alive, the other man has to die. If I have to live, the other man has to die. It cannot work. I owe it an urgent obligation to save myself and be alive.
Very passionate about this thing. I think language is also very key, because you talk about people sucking your blood and doing all those things. You're talking about renegotiation, so I think approaching it from a more pliable language would be better. But quickly, I also want to find out from you, I don't know what your thoughts are about this particular matter, because we're looking at ensuring that federating units are strengthened and ensuring that these federating units are strong. But at the same time, you know, the extreme of this argument is, let's have our own, let's control our own, and the belief being that if we do, it's going to be a land flowing with milk and honey. But we've seen recent examples of states who wanted to have their own, which has been a hotbed of crisis. South Sudan, case in point. Do you think that pursuing what you are agitating for, the other extreme part of it, and attaining it will automatically mean stability, peace, and prosperity for the region?
Don't you leave us to worry with that? Why do you point at South Sudan? How many of the countries that came out from Soviet Union are at war today? Why don't you cite the example of Czechoslovakia that has the Czech and the Slovakia, surviving and doing well today? Is Ukraine coming to beg food from anybody? Is Georgia coming to beg food from anybody? Why do you cite South Sudan, where we know the forces at play? So the matter, all these 36 states that were created by fiat, anybody who is hoping to build on such a foundation is going to come to naught in that thinking. Give me one example apart from Lagos colony that became Lagos state, that is still Lagos state. That's why Lagos is working. Lagos never came under this whole mess. But the people who were creating the states found a way to create internal strife. The people in the Warri area, the Urobo, the Shekiri, were looking for how to extricate themselves from the Benin control. They agitated for states. The states got created, and their Shaba became the capital. From that point to date, Delta State had not been the project of the Shekiri and the Urobo, who agitated for many years for it. You come to Port Harcourt, there's the upland, there's the waterland. You come to even Abia, there's Okwangwa, there's Bende. All kinds of things were embedded to make sure that people who should be reasoning together are not able to reason together. The things we're asking, the meat of the restructuring that people are talking about revolve around the 68 item exclusive list on the federal exclusive list in the Constitution. It is that list, and the people in the National Assembly who are carrying on in criminality of ignoring the fact that we have not mandated them to make constitutions on our behalf. Our contention is that we, the people, in exercise of our sovereignty, must decide the contents of the constitution, having first decided to live together. We have not decided to live together, and it must go to referendum. We will then decide after that referendum what we want to give for and what we want to keep. Those who sit in Abuja hoping that cancelling small and adding small are going to save this constitution, not one alphabet will survive from this constitution when the rains come. And that rain is so very near. And we're saying it is possible to avert it for us to accept that we have not discussed and go into that discussion as quickly as we can, so that it will be a consensual event.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Tony Nnadi is a secretary, Lower Niger Congress, and is very passionate about issues of restructuring and renegotiating Nigeria. He joined us from our Lagos Center. Thank you very much, Tony, for your time. All right, you're still watching Kakaaki, the African Voices Midweek Edition, Wednesday. We'll be taking a short break now, and when we return, we'll have something quite interesting for you. Stay with us.